So, chapter 13, looking at deformation, metamorphism, and time, how they relate, and how we can connect them. The first thing I want you to really look at is how pressure and temperature affect what metamorphic rocks we get. Different metamorphic assemblages, as they're called, are created at different temperatures and pressures because different minerals are stable at different pressures and temperatures. This here shows areas like this green schist area here, or this amphibolite area here, where anywhere within this white shape, amphibolite is stable. That's a metamorphic rock. However, if the temperature increases and stays noticeably hotter for a long period of time, geologically speaking, that amphibolite will not be stable. We may end up with granulite. It's a higher temperature metamorphic rock. Or, if the temperature drops and stays that way for a long time, we can end up with a green schist facies, or metamorphic rock. Not every single one of these has the same composition, so you can't always just shift from one to the other, but this gives you an idea of generally what metamorphic rocks are forming at what temperature pressure ranges. So sometimes you can shift from one to another, sometimes it simply won't be able to convert directly into the next metamorphic type because not all the correct minerals are present. It'll be something similar that has the high or lower pressure or temperature minerals. This three-part line with a dot in the middle, the dot is where the three areas meet, called a triple junction point, is looking at kyanite, which is the higher pressure mineral, sillimanite, which is the higher temperature mineral, and andalusite, which is the lower temperature and pressure mineral. All three of those minerals have the exact same chemical composition. They have the same chemical formula. The differences are the crystal structure, which changes based on temperatures and pressures that the mineral is at. These three completely convert into one another if they stay at the proper temperature and pressure for a long enough period of time. That will affect what metamorphic rocks there are, that'll affect, you know, what mineral assemblage there is, and when we go and we look at a rock, we can tell based on what mineral is there what temperature and pressure that rock was at until very recently. Now, these changes happen slowly in human terms. You know, geologic time is vast. Millions of years occur, or, you know, millions of years go by for these kinds of things to occur. So, when we bring a sample of sillimanite up to the surface and look at it in the lab, we don't have to worry about it converting into andalusite before we finish our study. We don't have to worry about it converting to andalusite before we finish living our lives. It takes a lot of time. However, looking at geologic history, there is a lot of time. Therefore, these transitions occur and can complete. Now, talking about does the rock change from one thing to another when we bring it up and start looking at it in the lab where the pressure and temperature have obviously changed, leads into talking about prograde and retrograde metamorphism. Prograde metamorphism means it's a history of increasing metamorphism, increasing pressure and temperature throughout the history of the rock. Retrograde is when the rock continues to be modified after its peak temperature and pressure, after its peak metamorphism. So basically, you know, you started out with something and you increase pressure and temperature and you convert into something else. Like, for example, if we back up a slide and say we started with a rock that had andalusite in it, you know, other things going on too, but just focusing on the andalusite. If we increase pressure and temperature, depending on which one increases more, we will either end up with kyanite or sillimanite, or possibly, if it falls perfectly on the line, some of each. That's prograde. If we snatch the rock right then and look at it, we can examine it and figure out that it's been undergoing prograde metamorphism. On the other hand, if it, you know, converts up to kyanite and sillimanite and then is partially uplifted closer to the surface, erosion happens, there's reduced pressure, there's less rock overburden, and reduced temperature, it's closer to the surface, it will start retrograde metamorphism, converting back to andalusite. And so that would be an example of, you know, the continued modification of the rock after its peak metamorphism. Some other good geobarometers, things that tell you about pressure, you know, you think of a barometer for checking air pressure, well, a geobarometer is something for checking rock pressure. Garnet plagioclase. This reaction, if we start getting more garnet, we know it's a much higher pressure system. The rock formed under extreme pressure. If we have no garnet and we have plagioclase, then we know it's a lower pressure system. Pyroxene plagioclase and quartz. Pyroxene is the higher pressure, higher temperature also, but specifically, since we're talking geobarometer, higher pressure, and then breaking down into plagioclase and quartz for lower pressure. The formation of phengite in muscovite. Phengite is what the muscovite can turn into under extreme pressure before it completely changes into new minerals by reacting with the other minerals around it. If we look at the hornblende and we look at the aluminum content, that can tell us about the pressure. So there are lots of different minerals and mineral combinations that we can look at in the lab to help pinpoint what pressure a rock formed at and stayed at for a long period of time. If we use multiple markers, it gives the best results. So a rock that has multiple minerals is easier to pin down what its formation pressure and also temperature was than something that's monomineralic. You know, a metamorphosed quartzite rock is all quartz. It doesn't have any geobarometer unless there are impurities in there, but generally speaking, there's no mineral that we can use as a geobarometer because it's all quartz. The quartz doesn't turn into anything. There's no geothermometer. The quartz doesn't turn into anything. However, something that has many minerals in it, we can find one or two or three or more different markers that we can trace.